All right, welcome, my dear friend. Welcome to the World 14.1 Tournament. I'm Alvin with Inside Pool. I'm here with the great George Fells, and we're going to do a match with Thorsten Hohmann and Alex Pagulayan, the Killer Pixie. Be getting underway here in just a moment. How are you feeling after that epic match with Charlie Williams and Johnny Archer there, George?
I'm worn out, but I'll rejuve myself somehow.
Good.
In Chicago, we're used to winning ugly, and so that didn't particularly surprise me. This particular match is fascinating in that it represents the tournament in miniature.
Oh.
There is no question who the better straight pool player is here, none whatsoever. On the other hand, there is no known formula for beating a player who makes everything at which he shoots.
Yeah.
Except to keep him in the chair. So you have a classic straight pool player, nine ball player confrontation here. You are not going to see any shot making better than Alex Pagulayan can show you.
Got that right.
And he's just learning to play straight pool. He doesn't have any use for the game. There isn't any action in it. I'm sure he doesn't play it in between tournaments. So between Derby City, which is mostly a long run contest, and this tournament, he has played, you can be sure he has played no straight pool and taken no instruction or anything else. And yet I see him running better patterns here than he was running in Louisville 7 months ago.
Wow.
It's just his pool instincts kicking in. Alex leads the cheers for himself. Everybody likes Alex.
Yeah.
His barber deserves death by lapidation, but everybody likes him.
Nice. Ooh, Thorsten.
Lapidation is death by stoning, the unfun way of getting stoned.
Let's hear it for the hitman, Mr. Thorsten
Hohmann. Yay.
There's one aspect of this tournament I question. It's the way they use the shot clock. I think 45 seconds from ball one would be a much more equitable way of doing business.
I don't think we're going to have too much of a problem with speed on
this
match.
Not with these players.
No. Thorsten ran 130 balls, and, well, you and I did the commentary on that. It was quick. It was about 40 minutes or so.
He ran 130 balls twice yesterday.
Yeah. Yeah, I was only witness to one of those.
Thorsten plays a beautiful game. Pace, everything you want to see.
Just a second here. Oops, there we go.
Okay. And Alex won the lag comfortably.
Oh, Bobby Chamberlain's out there. Great shooter.
I know, I'm not sure I know him.
Mm-hmm. See who else is out there in the chatties.
Well, we got our Superman, Dr. FedEx, sitting directly across from us.
Yes.
Next to him is Stuart Matana from New York in the brown shirt. He's another generous sponsor, straight pool in the New York area.
Nice.
Sponsor Dennis Walsh is our scorekeeper in the blue shirt.
Nice.
And I think we have both Carl and the gentleman who just racked the ball serving alternately as referees, so we're all set to go.
Nice.
All right, let's see if Thorsten can bring out two object balls.
Watch that five ball.
Yeah. Caught a little bit of the ball above the one, which is why he got this kind of scatter.
Boy, he didn't hit it like Cool Cat does, I'll tell you that much.
No, he sure didn't. If you watch Moscone play enough, you could see a perfect break where the two balls go back to their original positions and the incoming shooter has a 15-ball rack to shoot at.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yes, it is. I've done that a few times in my life, and I think I lost the rack every single time anyhow.
Jeez. Oh, he missed it.
You won't see that too often.
Yeah, that usually those first couple shots of the game, you're going to see some errors.
Among typical straight pool players, Alex is not that.
Yeah.
Normally he can shoot those long shots in till the roosters crow.
Yeah. Always a tough shot, though, that first shot.
First shot, answering the opening break is a challenge. Looks like Thorsten might have to go southpaw for that 11 ball. I don't see anything else except a safety, and I think he'd rather start scoring.
Yeah. They got a long way to go here, race to 200.
In a race to that many points, you will typically see players go through a funk for a few innings at one point or another. I don't think you're going to see that here. Thorsten is just too consistent and has to be considered a favorite to win among the four remaining players now that Charlie just won. The winner of this match catches Mike Davis, who was brilliant last night in sending Mike Siegel to his only defeat of the week.
Wow.
Thorsten's going to play a safety.
Smart move, Thorsten.
I'd have to bet Alex will accept the challenge of banking that six ball.
Mm-hmm. He made a nice bank in his match last week.
Tremendous one-pocket player. It's an elemental bank in one pocket. Mm. Beat him then too.
Yep. Say in the warm-up tournament that happened before this, Mike Davis had defeated Mike Siegel.
I would have called Davis's win a very modest upset given Siegel's background at straight pool, but Davis has an impressive straight pool resume too, although he's basically a nine-ball player.
Sure.
One of the more unusual strokes in the game. He's a big guy. He's about 6'4" and a great big spread-eagled stance.
Yeah.
He holds the cue at the very bottom, and he's got that seesaw effect before he delivers. But he's perfect at the point of contact, and that's what counts. His cue is perfectly level when the cue ball meets the cue tip. Okay, we got ourselves a safety battle in rack one here.
Good safety.
15 balls on the table. Alex could draw off this ball with left hand draw and come back into the stack off two rails. That's what he's going to do. Could have hit it a little harder, but it has the desired effect there. Frozen against those balls would be better, but be harder to return, but at least he left his opponent shotless. Our viewers get a fine shot here of the worst haircut in professional sports, possibly in the history of professional sports.
He left Alex tough, man. I don't know what he's got here.
Well, he's shotless to begin with. The problem with this safety is that it's difficult to return.
Hmm. Yeah, there's so many open balls. He's got to basically draw back into the rail.
I think I'd roll a 13 into the 6 and leave the cue ball in between the 4 and the 12.
Nice. He's looking at that right now.
He's looking at the 13, 9 in the side is what he's looking at.
Oh, he's going to go aggressive.
I don't think I'd go for this.
Mm-mm. But this guy's an amazing shot maker, so who knows.
Good call, George.
Nice.
Exactly what I said he'd do. Mm. Even a stop clock is right twice a day. I don't know if he left him that 4 on the side or not. I guess that's the 8. They're all on the table.
Thorsten. Safety, safety.
Thorsten has the all-time longest run in this tournament.
Oh, he does.
But, you know, by far, but as usual, since the tournament was not sanctioned, it's not in the record books, but he did go 174 balls against John Schmidt in the inaugural of this tournament.
Nice.
It's more than nice.
Mm-hmm.
Not quite a 13-rack run. That's pretty sporty. Except for challenge matches, that's the best anybody's ever done for the record.
Wow. Touchy little shot here. Ooh.
I'm not surprised that he made it, though.
Yeah.
This is the highest order of shot making you're likely to see in
yep.
pool.
Amazing player.
Alex with some loose balls and some work to do. We'll see how he negotiates this.
No, that
this is where you separate the trotters from the pacers when it comes to straight pool.
Mm. He's looking at that combo, but I don't really think it's
he's looking
smart.
All over here. He's looking all over. You don't want to begin with a combination when
no.
you have open balls.
Mm-hmm. He can play any.
He's trying to figure out a sequence here. I think he's going to play the ball up table. He should, and then get one of those two balls in the side.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, the rest is the only real problem, these two balls nearest us, which need to be separated. That's easily accomplished, though.
Dardusum said, I watched the 174 ball run in person, and it was impressive.
I was there. I was there. John missed a break shot, and then he sat in the chair till the end of the game.
Wow.
Alex is correctly going for the problem areas early in this sequence.
Mm-hmm.
And there go the 7 and 8 balls. Let's see if he moved the 8 ball outside the rack area. If he did, it's just barely out.
It is just barely outside the rack.
I'd have rather seen him take those 2 balls by the side pocket off after he made the 5. But this is still all right. I believe they snuck in a pink 4 ball on me just to make me look foolish.
No, we made sure they got rid of those TV balls last night.
Well, we had purple for the first match.
Oh, nice.
I don't see the 4 ball now, unless it's that ball over to our left, and that's not the color I care to see. Alex didn't really have to do that to pocket that ball on the side. Both those balls were makeable before he separated them. I think making the 3 ball on the side would have been the wiser play, but it doesn't figure to be too much to his disadvantage. Bumps that break ball out there quite sophisticatedly.
Yeah.
Good key ball just above it.
I'm a fan of his bent arm. I like the bent arm. I use a straight locked arm for my bridge.
And that's what most teachers teach is, straight so you can be as solid in your stance as possible.
But I noticed the bent arm guys like Shane and Alex here, they produce a perfectly straight stroke with just the tiniest movement in that arm.
Oh, sure, but you're talking about 1 in 1,000 talent, or maybe even 1 in 10,000.
Yeah, unusual for sure.
All right, I think Alex will go 7-1-11-4. Or he could go 7-4-1-11. Okay, my first guess appeared to be right.
He grabs the very back end of the cue.
Yeah, he does. Yeah, that's one way of compensating for his height.
Mm-hmm.
Claims to be able to dunk a basketball. But Muggsy Bogues couldn't. If Muggsy Bogues couldn't, I don't see how this man can. Muggsy was a little smaller than Alex. Muggsy was 5'3". I think Alex got him there.
Yeah, I'd have to see that one in person.
8-foot baskets, maybe.
Carl says he told him he can't do it.
Can't? Okay. I'd have to bet against him. Uh-huh. His hands aren't big enough for one thing, and then there's the question of his jumping ability. Mm. And you're talking about an athlete who plays pool and nothing else except poker.
Yeah, you don't get too much calisthenic workout playing
poker.
Yeah,
no, you don't do any trimming, except maybe of your bankroll.
Nice. A surplus of riches. That's what you said yesterday. Mm-hmm, yeah. I was trying to remember that all. That was fun. That was a good one.
Actually, Alex played that rack pretty fairly well. This referee is slower than any player I've ever seen. But at least we know the balls are racked perfectly. I wonder why they don't use that plastic template that all the other tournaments are using.
I'm not sure.
Get a perfect rack every time.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Okay, Alex comes back to the center of the table just like you're supposed to. The exact center.
No, he didn't crush that. He left some balls in the rack area.
No, that's what new cloth and polished balls will do for you. On a worn table, a typical commercial room, you'd see these players hitting the balls harder. They're taking advantage of the equipment as they should.
So this looks like an okay break to you?
Oh, sure.
All right. Gonna fire in the nine there.
Yeah, you want to take care of up-table balls early in your sequence. They can't help you later on. Get rid of them and get back to business. The 10 would be an appropriate shot for him to take here. It opens up the 11-5, and that's the last remaining cluster up there. The 7-13 need a divorce, but the 13 could be made as a combination in a pinch. I don't see any other problems here.
He only thinks for a few minutes per rack, and then he just goes ahead and runs them out. I think he figures the whole sequence out.
He's got the whole game to learn. There isn't that much thinking he can do. But he's finding open shots that lead him productively to other open shots, and that's the foundation of straight pool.
And then being a tremendous shot maker
if
helps.
If you want to, it helps immeasurably. And then if you want to get into this game seriously, there are teachers available to him, but he has no reason to get into it seriously.
Right. There's not a lot of market for this.
There's not a lot of market for any kind of pool, but
sure.
Least of all this.
Yeah, unfortunate.
I mean, there's no market for it among the gamblers. It's too slow, and,
yeah.
and people won't bet anything at it. In another era, people would, but not now.
Mm-hmm. Back when they had table maids.
And table porters.
Table porters. What did they do?
Same thing table maids did, except they had a penis.
Oh, man.
The downtown Bensingers had both. They were good people, too. They check your cue, check your coat. Sure.
Carl said they used to wear aprons.
I still do.
Oh, you still wear an apron when you play?
My pants will get filthy if I don't. Uh-huh. They clean the cloth where I play. They don't clean the rails real well. Mm-hmm. And my cleaner once told me my pants had to go through twice to get clean.
Wow. Yeah, I know another player in Akron that plays with an apron on. Kind of unusual. But, yeah, it's smart.
It's smart. You carry around the chalk in the little pocket you get. And, keep your pants clean. I mean, it's a great game. It is not worth sacrificing your pants for.
I'll wear a lab coat.
A smock,
if that's
yeah.
the case. Nice break up there.
My dentist
once
had occasion to treat Mick Jagger on a Sunday. My dentist stays open on Sundays, and they had an emergency. So he was told, don't offer to shake hands and don't ask for an autograph. He may let you take a picture. But he's just coming in like any other patient to have his mouth worked on. And my dentist said, okay, I understand. So Jagger agreed to pose for a picture, and my dentist appeared in his lab smock with his laboratory glasses on. And I call that picture Sir Jagger with Dork.
Nice. Don't shake his hand, huh?
No handshakes.
Must be one of them OCD guys.
Don't ask for an autograph. Those are the terms if you want his business today.
Oh, man.
Okay, we won't. Oh. Promise.
He must not want to get any germs on him, even yeah. though he's made of germs. The human body is more filthy inside than it is you're ever going to get to shake a hand, I'll tell you that.
I think his insides would be pristine compared to Keith's.
Nice.
And in this era, I think his debauchery is probably overestimated. After all, he's 68 years old.
Yeah.
And he might want to consider growing up.
That's no fun.
I didn't say it was, but he might consider it.
The Lion. Now he's got the double break ball
double
thing
break
going
ball
on.
Thing.
See, I'm learning.
Yes, and Alex is not, but he'll pick up on this. One of those break balls, unless you land straight on it, is not likely to lead you well to the other.
Mm. One doesn't lead well to the other.
No. Well, this is good, too. He could play either ball and go and get position on the other, but this is one of those rare examples of where you can use two.
Mm-hmm.
Use the two break balls.
He wants the farther away ball so he gets that extra travel and speed acceleration you were talking about.
Yeah, I think so. Farther away ball is a better choice than most players think. Okay, we have Ed Deska, plus a racker for the balls, plus a scorekeeper.
Nice.
Yeah, we're all set
here. He's cleaned the ball there real nice.
Yeah, I think we ought to run the hotel concierge into the tournament room in case the players need anything.
Yep.
Complimenting scorekeeper, dual referees, and table cleaner, ball cleaner.
Mm-hmm.
Ed Deska is a good guy, good player, fine chess player too, and his son is one of the best players in Maryland.
Wow!
But he won't play straight pool.
Huh?
Says, Dad, why do you want to play that? You make 100 easy shots, and then a hard shot comes up, and you can't make it.
Yep. That's it. We've seen that several times this tournament. Players on big runs, and then just making the tiniest little error.
Yep. Doesn't take much. So Alex is pitching a two-rack shutout so far.
Mm-hmm.
Still going.
27 to nothing.
Oh, I believe it'll be 28.
Mm-hmm. He's got to hit this three ball.
He did.
Yeah.
And the cue ball died in center table,
nice.
Just like it's supposed to.
Beauty. Boy, that was a nice shot there. Yeah. It hopped off the rack and then forward spin stopped it.
Hopped off the rack and had massive cardiac arrest.
Yeah, it
just
did.
Just what you want.
That was really nice. Got a nice spread. He's still got a few balls in the break area to deal with, but that's the fun of straight pool.
He's got shots that are going to give him trouble in reaching.
Oh, I see.
See how wide he's stretched out here? We don't recommend this at all, but this is a player with outstanding control.
Man, he played that shot nice.
Room
433. This is room. Okay. Yeah, Carl had mentioned that Alex is the Canadian snooker champion. They play on 6x12 tables.
And he's only been playing snooker for a month or two, and he's already accomplished a perfect frame.
Wow.
That's 36 shots in a row on that 6x12 with pockets one ball wide.
Sure. The balls are a little...
If he wants to make money at the Q game, snooker is the game he should be playing.
Is that the game?
And he should be playing it in Asia.
Yeah.
Where it pays off to the tune of hundreds of thousands of dollars a year for the best players.
Wow, I didn't know that. I thought Europe would be the place to play snooker, but I guess it's Asia, huh?
In Hong Kong, they have two cable channels showing snooker 24/7.
Wow.
They have a snooker soap opera.
Wow.
It's just inconceivable how snooker crazy the whole place is.
That's nuts. No pool, though, huh?
No, it's snooker. Well, Asia loves pool, particularly in Japan and Taiwan. But in Hong Kong, snooker rules, and it's so hard. It's one reason it's never going to catch on here.
Rare occurrence using the bridge. Says,
well, when you're 5 foot four, you have to make that a more common occurrence or learn to shoot left-handed. There are going to be a lot of shots you can't reach. When Boston Shorty was alive, Jersey Red used to handicap him. The Shorty could sit on the table, and that's a strong handicap.
Yeah, it is.
Imagine all the shots the man couldn't reach. He was shorter than his cue.
Wow. Boston Shorty, huh?
Uh-huh. Another Hall of Fame player. Not that I'm sure why. He won more one-pocket tournaments than any other player, but at the time he was elected, the BCA didn't even recognize one-pocket as a game, so I don't know exactly what his credentials were. Hmm.
Maybe he was just a character. Good representation.
Character? Yeah.
Maybe not, though. I don't know.
I knew the man slightly. There wasn't really much to him. Hmm.
Well, some people just get lucky, I guess.
I mean, there's no question he was a great player in both three-cushion and pool, but...
Three-cushion.
Fine three-cushion player, but, didn't have much of a sense of humor. He had a limp fish handshake. There really wasn't much... And once you took him away from the pool table, there really wasn't much remaining to the man.
Mm-hmm. Carl said he was a cab driver.
He did drive a cab in both Boston and New York. And he gave lessons, too. Just right to nudge the 11 and 3 apart. Saving the 5. Or maybe it's the 4. Just right. This 12 ball should have come off the rail before this. Mm-hmm. We can see why it's giving Alex a modest problem now.
directs that cue ball so nice.
He does. It's at his command.
Mm-hmm.
But before he gets to the cue ball, he controls his body, and that's what's really at the core of his success. You have complete control over your body and your cue, some measure of indirect control over the cue ball, none whatsoever over the object balls. For all the body English you see, and guys contorting themselves trying to steer a ball in, if that worked, I'd have been world champion long before this, along with about 500,000 other guys. This is the same pattern, break shot pattern Alex played last rack.
Yep, the two
one,
balls.
One ball above the other and to the rail and out again. I don't know what the dilemma is here.
It's a tough cut. He's got to hit a real center ball.
It's not a tough cut. The tough part of this is gauging the cue ball speed. The shot's simplicity itself to him.
I see players miss this ball sometimes. Not Alex, though. He never misses anything.
Twice across the table. I wouldn't have opted for that.
No.
But as a nine-ball player, that's probably what he's more comfortable with.
Now, George, you've written some books.
I have.
From what I understand. And how do people – and what are the books called, and how do people get a hold of them?
Well, the original book is no longer being published under its original title. That was Mastering Pool in 1979. Mm-hmm. It's been revised as Advanced Pool. My publishers do a miserable job of getting it out there, but I imagine Amazon could get you one.
Okay. Is there any website? Do you have a website?
I do not.
No?
No. I'm a technological dinosaur. I can use the internet. I can word process. I can send and receive email. That's all the use I have for computers.
And you're a writer for Billiards Digest, correct?
Right.
Writer?
31 years now. Featured columnist on the back, on the back page.
Nice.
On this occasion, I'm going to write up this tournament, too. I hope that when I'm gone, or if I don't expect to leave the magazine, I hope that when I'm gone, my replacement doesn't get a column titled that. Not only did I think of that name, but...
What's the name?
Tips and Shafts. That's my property. That's really my property.
Oh, I gotcha. Well, of course, nobody would take that from you. Respect is number one, man.
How? Alex will try and get position on the nine ball here to open these up. Means he soft rolls in the eight first. Or is
the
that
six,
the
six?
The six is the bottom ball.
The
I think
four.
The four. I think he's going to go for the six and save the four for his insurance ball. That's what that's what Moscone would have done.
So he's going to go up into the nine right now off the bottom rail.
Oh, no. I'd shoot the six with left-hand spin and come over here and play position for the nine in the other corner.
Gotcha.
And then you have the four as an insurance ball. That's what he's doing.
Nice.
Just right.
Yeah, that way he didn't get buried in the stack there.
Didn't get buried in the stack, and he can count on at least one ball after the break here.
He's looking for a dead ball?
No, I don't know what that was about. I guess we're destined not to know that.
Yeah.
But this is the shot. The four ball is the insurance ball. And
Beauty.
He left his cue ball right where he could get to the insurance ball. So that's just what you want.
He's still got some heavy-duty work to do here.
Yeah, I think I would come around here off to the left and get on the 10 next. But that's me. The 14-11 looks like it might go in the side if he ever needs it. I don't think it's going to come to that. He's going to begin with the 10. Which is good if he wants to take the one ball off next, and he should. Nope.
Yeah, you figure he would have gone for that one next.
You want to get that offer sooner rather than later. It can't possibly do you any good up there. One thing you might consider here is 15 is a stop shot and play the 8 next, and he's going to pass that up. Don't do that.
It's not clustered yet.
No, it's not a cataclysmic error,
right.
But he should have left it right where it was. You can separate the 14-11 right here.
The double break ball. He is outside the line with the
green
stripe. With
that 14, I don't think he'll leave it, though.
No, it's too close.
The 5 or the 15 are both better.
That kind of shot there, the cue ball stops right at the rack if you hit
it. Well, it loses a lot of its momentum upon object ball contact, and then it has to take on the mass.
Right. It pretty much probably just stops right there. It pockets the ball and just dies.
Alex right on just the side. Got the traditional nice hand for a 50 ball run.
Oh, nice. I didn't know that.
Yeah, the old-time referees would always ask the crowd for a hand for 50.
Nice.
That originated with the famous Cue Ball Kelly.
Okay.
New York's best-known referee. Hmm. He was Italian, but that became his moniker. His name was Zingali.
Hmm.
And one day somebody only heard the last two syllables, and that became Kelly.
Hmm.
Now you don't want to shoot that. Shoot the 13, withdraw, and come back for the 1.
All right, they're saying they can get your book at bebopublishing.com.
Oh, is that right? I didn't know Bob had any of my books, but I'm glad to hear it.
Snooker Sandy added that in. Says.
I'm glad to hear it. Bob is an author himself.
He's a great author. Bob Henning.
Right.
Yeah, I love his articles in Inside Pool. Inside Pool Magazine, your streaming host here. And we are honored to have Billiards Digest writer George Fells with us. I'm Alvin with Inside Pool. We're here at the World Straight Pool Championships, called the World 71st World Tournament, 14-1 World Tournament, but...
It's the 71st tournament held with "world" in the title.
Oh, gotcha.
Since it's not being sanctioned, what it comes down to is a fine tournament, a fine field, a fine prize fund.
Yeah,
and these. But players, the winner will go unrecognized.
Yeah,
and that's a shame.
Yeah, these players, they know they're playing for the world title, though, in their minds. So.
No, that's yes. If they're comfortable with that, so am I. But I really, I find it almost impossible to get behind the notion.
Yeah, they can't
of a
do
champion
it.
With no recognition. You beat a field like this, you deserve the honor of beating a field
like
this.
That's a shame.
I don't think everything. I don't think prize fund should be the sole criterion in.
Well, you got to pay for that sanctioning, you know.
Determining sanctioning. Well, I don't think that money should be the end-all and be-all. It isn't the end-all and be-all of anything else.
All right.
Alex will play this softly and play the 4 in the opposite, or the 8, whichever it is, in the opposite corner. Probably come down far enough that he's going to go to the rail and out again. I wouldn't have done that. Now he can go two rails or 1 to get on the 15. He can go 2 rails in either direction, actually.
Mm.
Most players would shoot this with high left and just go off the end rail and try and come up above the 15 with an angle. Let's see what Alex prefers. Looks like he's using left. Look out. All right. Just as called by the narrowest of margins in a 56-ball run for Alex Pagulayan.
Nice.
It has been nice.
56-0, my friends.
Charlie Williams led by the same score last time, and the match went 4 hours.
So yeah,
you can't predict anything out of that.
They were on a shot clock, too.
Eventually.
That's strange it went... 4 hours and they were on a shot clock after.
Last night they wanted to put the Siegel match on a shot clock when the match only had about 20 balls to go.
Wow.
And in addition, the Olhausen crew was striking tables with a match still in progress. That can't be right.
Yeah, that's... Yeah, Mike got a little lot upset.
A very unpleasant confrontation with Charlie Williams over there.
Sure was. Which, being the tournament director and owner of the tournament... Probably might not have been the smartest idea by Mike Siegel.
It didn't make a lot of political sense.
Yeah.
He had a legitimate beef about the tables being struck, though.
The way he was acting, though, was a little outrageous.
He's been acting that way all week. And Charlie even told him, we've been putting up with your griping all week long. meantime, he had never lost a game with all his pitching. Yeah. He's got a beautiful woman at his side.
Yeah, he was exceptionally negative, though, last night. I think that's what got it. He was beyond his normal.
I think he got tired.
Yeah, he was just getting tired.
He's in his early 60s now. We saw Danny Burruti run out of gas. We saw Ray Martin run out of gas. 200 points is a lot of pool.
That is.
And Siegel claims to be in great shape. He's discovered the joys of chiropractic, so his back and neck aren't bothering him. He's doing road work. He's got that gorgeous girlfriend. There's really nothing to bitch about.
Mm.
Most of us would trade places with him.
Yeah.
He made a fortune from Kevin Trudeau. I'll spare you the adjectives for Kevin Trudeau. The only one who made any money off him was Siegel. Alex piling up balls over to our right.
Oh, it's funny. Siegel's just as likable as he is unlikable sometimes,
If you get him away from Poole, he's fine.
Yeah.
Anywhere near Poole and the conversation is going to come to Mike Siegel every single time.
Yeah, I'd be anxious to see his matchup with Earl.
Oh, in terms of talk?
Yeah, just...
I'd rather listen to Siegel.
Yeah.
I'm from the north.
Uh-huh. Yeah, they're both entertaining players, that's for sure. Good or bad, however you...
I don't find Strickland particularly entertaining, but a lot of people do.
Mm-hmm.
I respect the fact that he understands you have to do more than pocket balls if you want to get anybody's attention, but I think he went at it the wrong way.
Yeah.
This isn't tennis, and we don't need another McEnroe, and that was always the comparison he made.
Yep.
But tennis is played before presidents and royalty, and... I can't read that from here.
Yeah, I can read. They're asking about who won with Archer and Williams. Charlie won. After four and a half hours.
You might want to say a little thank you to the powers that be that you weren't here. It wasn't particularly pretty, although you have to give Charlie his props for running that last rack under colossal pressure. Both men needed a rack to win. If you miss any given ball, you're going to lose the game.
Yeah, Archer missed a break shot at 188.
Mm-hmm. Alex didn't get what he wanted out of that. I'm not sure what that was, but I can tell by his body language that that was not the desired result.
Yeah. He kind of smacked the chalk down there a little bit.
We can all see over to our left there, the 10, 13, and 4 make a fine last three balls to save. These balls got to go, Alex. There's just no other way to put it. You've got to take the 11, 1, and 3 off the table.
Yep. Yeah, you can just do them in order. 11, 3, 1. But he's not going to go that way. Maybe he wants a better shape on him.
He can't get better shape than he has right now.
Yeah, he's got great shape on these.
And the old saying, if don't play position when you have position.
Yeah. Looks like he's drawing off the... He must have a plan going on, so...
I guess he's going to use the 5 to get on the 11 or 3.
That's strange. He was just on him.
And better than maybe he can get slightly better position, but he didn't need it. He was on him ideally.
Like you said, don't play shape if you got it.
Well, he's back. He's pretty much back where he was.
Yeah, he is. He knows he's got to deal with these balls right now.
This little man ran 100 balls on the first day of play.
Nice. That's what's great about pool. It doesn't matter how big you are, how small you are, if you're a woman, a man, a kid, an old person, handicapped.
Strength is not even desirable.
Nope. It doesn't matter who you are. You can win. You can beat all these guys. Who was that? 56 minus 1 for Dennis Hatch, and he ran out. 101 and got out twice.
Alex? I like Dennis Hatch's straight pool game.
Yeah, he was enjoyable to watch. Made some silly mistakes, but...
Well, he had a very lucky win against Zion V.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I like his game. He plays better straight pool than a lot of people mm-hmm. think. I don't think he has much use for the game either.
Yep. He's the...
But, you know, basic pool instincts and good fundamentals.
Uh-huh. He's like a big kid, too.
Yeah, he is. Know? St. Bernard.
Right. Like a grown-up kid.
Dennis's father was Danny DiLiberto's best friend, lifelong. These players like their shafts slick. That's why you see them pausing in mid-rack to wipe down. Hmm. Johnny Archer's a slickness freak.
Yeah, he's got the little OCD going on there.
Yeah, his shafts are like glass, and he wants them kept that way.
He picks that lint off the table.
Everything, yeah. Everything has to be just so.
Uh-huh. I did commentary with him at Seminole Tour. It was really fun, actually. And
oh, really? That's interesting.
I interviewed him, and I asked him, I said, Johnny, is there really anything there? And he said, yep, there's something there. There is something there on
there
the table.
There is something there.
Yep, there's something there. All right, this one ball has to go disappear-o.
And it should have come off before this, but he's got a good angle on it now to draw over to the, well, now it's the whale on our right to get to that key ball. You want to get straight in on that key ball, or at the very least, a very slight angle of a few degrees. Alex's shutout is going to go to 5 racks here.
Wow.
That was just about ideal. He could even follow this ball, maybe a ball width or so, get a little more.
Can he leave the cue ball in the rack and get a kitchen shot?
He doesn't have to.
He can play this okay and
sure.
be able to get into the rack okay?
Oh, he's fine.
All right, yeah, that looks like a good one there, huh?
He's fine.
Mm-hmm. He's going to track off those top two balls, then, it looks like.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. So he'll be going back
it's
up table.
It's approximately all he can hit, and uh-huh. he'd be wise not to hit his cue ball too low so he doesn't come back too far up table. Just above center will do.
Hmm. What are the payouts for this tournament? Does anybody know?
20,000.
20,000 for first.
20,000 for first.
It's a big pool payday.
What is second?
9,000.
Carl says 9,000 for second. Man, that's huge. Yeah,
that's
big.
Big jump.
20 grand, man. That's quite a payday.
That's not a bad payday for 4 days of work. Or non-work.
Yeah, non-work. The unemployed, you know. Or
I'd have worked for less than that.
What do you say? You play pool when you're in the day if you're unemployed, or what was that?
Yeah, the only funny. People who play pool at noon are the unemployed.
Right. Love it. They're asking, why is there a spot on both sides of the table?
It doesn't come up very often, but every now and then, the object ball and the object ball will be behind the string, and the cue ball gets left in the rack. In that case, the cue ball goes on that head spot, and the ball behind the string is fair game.
Wow.
Not many pool players know that. Like I say, it doesn't come up very often.
That's just for straight pool, huh?
Uh-huh.
Wow, I see that.
It's the only game in which the head spot has any function at all.
Hmm, interesting. Well, there you asked it, MN Shooter. There you go. Mastermind. Mr. Fells let you know that. Yeah, I heard you know all about the history.
Oh, my colleague, Mr. Seamus, is the historian.
Mr. Seamus?
Yeah, there's nobody like him.
Hmm.
The entire universe runs a distant second to Michael Chamus when it comes to pool history.
Interesting. I wonder who invented nine ball.
He'd be the person to ask.
He'd be the guy, huh? I know it was for like horse race track racing back in the day, or for gambling at horse tracks.
Nine ball had no use except as a gambling medium. Mm-hmm. I know it's become the tournament staple, but that's only because it's television friendly. I still don't think it's much of a game.
I like this straight pull. It's nice. I mean, it's not going to attract the NFL crowd too much, but.
No, it's always going to be struggling to survive, I think.
It's because it's not big shots.
Well, we desperately need a champion charismatic enough to capture the media's attention.
Sure.
Moscone was barely that, mm-hmm. but he was a dominant champion, and that's the story that America's sports fans will buy into.
Well, they still talk about the guy.
Any dominant champion, no matter how big a creep he is, and that includes Bobby Fischer,
yeah.
If you're kicking ass universally, uh-huh. the press will pay attention.
Yeah, he lived till he was 64.
Yes.
And that's how many spots there are on a chessboard.
I suppose there's some irony in that. He was as nutty as a fruitcake.
Yeah, he was a big conspiracy nut.
But there hasn't been anybody like him playing
Amazing
chess.
Amazing player. Yeah. Yeah, but people who don't know anything about pool know who Willie Moscone is.
Yeah, they do.
That's amazing, considering he's been gone for so long.
Actually, stop 100 people at random and ask them to name 4 pool players. This has been tested in surveys. Yeah. The first name that come up will be Jeanette Lee.
Jeanette Lee, every time, isn't
every
it?
Time. She's the most tireless self-promoter in all pool.
Yeah.
The second name will be Minnesota Fats.
Yep.
Third will be Moscone, and fourth will be that guy in the beer commercials whom they can't identify by name. That's only pool players who have invaded the American consciousness.
Wow, the guy in the beer commercials, Mr. Mizrak.
Yep.
Carl says some people told him Paul Newman was a great pool player.
Compared to what they've seen, maybe.
Uh-huh. Now, but Mike Siegel trained him, didn't he?
No, he
that
did
movie?
Not. Moscone did.
Moscone trained him.
Mike Siegel was technical advisor for The Color of Money, and he showed Paul Newman how to break in nine ball.
Oh, okay.
That's how he got the job. He told Paul Newman, next time you break the balls, hit it about 70% as hard as you can and hit the head ball as fully as you can. Newman went to the table, sunk the nine ball, and said to Scorsese, hire this guy. And he made 40, 50 grand with that piece
of
advice.
That's the Mike Siegel we like hearing about.
He had 3 weeks of lessons with Moscone, 6 days a week, 5 hours a day.
Wow.
He had never held a cue before, and at the end of the 3 weeks, he ran 23 balls.
Nice.
Yeah. Moscone, of course, appears in the film as the stakes holder. Most trivia experts know that.
I didn't know that.
Watch closely. You'll see.
I'll have to watch that movie.
He even says, will he give me the stakes money the first time they play?
I'll have to watch that again and see that. I know that Grady Matthews and Keith McCready are both in that
That's
movie.
That's The Color of Money.
Oh, okay. Oh, The Hustler is what
the
you guys are
talking
about. Okay,
yeah.
So Willie Moscone's in The Hustler.
Yes, and that's the only film of the two.
Okay.
Color of Money is a touchstone commercial.
Yeah.
Piece of caca, as far as I'm concerned, but it did do the industry some good, so I have to respect that.
Yeah, you were in the industry at that time. That probably gave it a really nice boost.
Sure.
Pretty instantly, huh?
It lasted much longer than the little boom that they got out of The Hustler, which only lasted about 3 years.
Huh.
Some rooms opened and people came to play in them, and then it all faded away. The boom after Color of Money stuck around for a while.
That's good.
So there's that.
That's what we have. One movie from 1984.
One fair movie from 1984 and one great one from 1962.
Our glorious sport. The sport of kings and gentlemen, is that what it was?
I think the sport of kings is usually reserved for backgammon.
I didn't know that. Which Alex plays quite a bit of.
Well, sure, you can bet on it.
He was looking for a backgammon board, a really nice one here.
They're certainly available.
The Filipinos, they love those gambling games, like them little gambling games.
Mahjong, sure.
Uh-huh.
Efren plays Mahjong for hours a day.
Oh, my gosh. Those guys play chess, everything. Every time I go to a tournament, there's a pile of Filipinos over in a corner gambling on chess or backgammon.
Efren is a tremendous games player. Mm-hmm. He even plays good gin rummy.
Gin rummy. Nice.
Yeah. Good. He plays superb chess.
All right, we're getting some input from the chat about our discussion here.
Oh, that he didn't run 70 balls from the break? I didn't say he did. He missed the game's first shot, and then they had a safety battle, and he got the first open shot, and he's running these balls.
They're talking about the movies and stuff.
Yep. Six-rack run for Alex Pagulayan. Moving right along.
Wow, he's still on the roll. Now, if he runs 200... He wins
the game.
Is that a record? Or?
Oh, well, an unofficial one.
Unofficial.
Nothing about this tournament is going to be recorded.
Yeah. Has that ever been done in a world tournament?
No. Thorsten's 174 is the
best. He's the guy, huh?
The best ever anybody has done outside the realm of challenge matches in which it was possible to run more than 150 balls.
I see.
That record is 182. Hmm. And it was set on a 5x10.
Wow, 5x10.
By Joe Procida, a player I actually beat, although by the time I got to him, he was maybe 20% of his original self.
Hmm. Ooh, I don't think he got the breakout he wanted.
Two balls came out.
Uh-huh.
And he's on the rail with one of them. Now, we need to look at that ball nearest us. It looks pretty close to be going.
What happened there?
He
just didn't hit enough of the rack, obviously.
He could have stood to hit that ball either slightly softer or slightly harder. All rolls, good or bad, come back to the speed of the cue ball. I don't know what he's measuring here. Probably looking to see if he can play that top ball on the side after he pockets the three. Up and down the table is what he's looking to accomplish. And he played that with a lot of left-handed draw, and it's not quite going to get where he wanted
to. No, he's straight in.
Are you kidding me?
He's not going to be able to go into this.
I don't think so. Not without over-hitting the ball. He may play the 6 if it goes.
What about this 13 up on the side? Can he crack that 13 up in the corner and run in? I don't know if he's got space.
I don't think he can get to the 13.
Hmm. Wonder if there's any dead balls.
I don't see anything. I think he's going to draw back for this and try and play position on the 6. I don't see trying to go into the rack from here. But he did.
Whoa.
And no rewards.
He's got.
There's no rewards. I don't think he can get to the 13.
Can he even play the 10 there? The 12 ball?
He'll never reach the cue ball.
He can't even reach it. They do have that double bridge, though, that double locking bridge.
Yeah, they have that. But, you're talking about an extremely short man stretching an extremely long way. There's no worse place on the table for a cue ball object ball combination than down at the foot.
Jeez. Yeah, he's in big trouble here. This could end his run. You know Thorsten's back there interested.
If his run ends, my fondest hope is that Thorsten comes to the table and runs some balls. Our viewers deserve to see a match in which both players run some balls. This is a thankless proposition here. Well, he played it safe. So his run ends in the well into the 80s.
Oh, that's a shame.
85, I guess.
Well, Thorsten has about
85, 86. I think 86 was his
86?
Run. I think so.
Okay.
No, Thorsten doesn't have anything, as Alex intended that he not have.
Carl says he's looking at the eight ball.
A few years ago, AccuStats had a competition where they invited several top straight pool players to come and play 60-point games for DVDs, and Danny DiLiberto was of the opinion Thorsten was one of the greatest straight pool players of all time.
He loves straight pool, you can tell.
Yes, he does. All the Europeans do. They treat it as a real sport for which they take instruction and train and drill. They won't bet. The only European player known to gamble is Niels Fion. Mika will take a money game every now and then, but I don't think he's partial to it. Mm-hmm. Playing pool for money doesn't mean anything to them. And in Mika's home country of Finland, he claims it's unheard of for two strangers to play pool for money.
Wow. Well, the governments over there are sponsored the pool players, I think, and some of the big companies over there.
To some degree.
Neil said he got a Volkswagen from...
Really?
Yeah, they gave him a Volkswagen.
That's a good sponsor.
Mm-hmm. He's looking at rail first into the pack.
He's found a combination. I don't know what the ball is. I didn't hear the call.
I thought he said five ball.
Five ball off the six, okay.
I don't know.
That's the ball just inside the 13.
Oh,
he's going to play into this left-hand corner pocket.
Rail first into the pack, five ball down in the pocket.
I guess so.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Wow.
Pretty, great shot.
Pretty bloody good. All right, Thorsten, let's see you run some balls now. There's a very slight angle on this six. He could go forward two rails if he chose.
Yep, this is a single elimination round here, so.
That's another change in the tournament that I'm not crazy about. They used to play double elimination until they got to the last 16, and then they played single elimination from there. It made the tournament go longer, but it's more fair to the players who have been winning. Siegel lost one game all week, and he's out.
Wow. Yeah, when they get up to these races to 200, it'd take forever to do a double elimination.
Well, that's the way they did it up until this year.
It was double elimination race to 200?
Until they got to 16. They went from 32 to 16 in double elimination.
I see.
The last 16 were single elimination.
Of course.
And double elimination was only to 150 points.
I see.
And then single elimination was 200. This is the only tournament that sends its players to 200 points. In Europe, the last 16 go to 150. Tell you in full confidence that this 13 ball is going in.
Beauty.
It sure was.
He's got three potential break balls, the 11, 1, and the 2.
Mm-hmm. Or even the 8 if he wanted to push things. But the 1, 11, 2, and 8 are going to need to be fiddled with because there are pocket blockers involved. I think he'll probably shoot the 14 and come back for the 7 and move one of those balls. As called.
Mm-hmm. Bump the one out.
And now he can, well, the easiest shot for him here is the 11.
Yeah.
So he can either use the 2 as a key ball or save it for the break shot. The 2 and the 8 are both attractive. Needs to find a way to get to the right of the 9 and 4.
Boy, doesn't he just pick this 4 ball off right now?
It's a tricky cut from where he is.
Mm-hmm.
If he plays the 9 first, the cue ball comes off the 4, and that's not what you want.
Uh-huh.
Well, now he can use the 8 to get on the 9 and 4, and the 2 ball will be his break shot. The 1 ball is not ideal as a cue ball, but it'll work. Let's see, 80 or 90 balls here. Well, I want a match where you fire at each other. Anybody can collapse when they're down. Right now he's plotting his course from the last of these 2 balls nearest the cue ball to the 1, and whether he wants the 1 in the top right corner or down here in the bottom right. It'd be easier to stay underneath it from where he is now. Most players would prefer not to send a ball up there. Another option is he could go to the rail here, play the 1 and stop, and shoot the 2 in the side. That was Greenleaf's favorite shot.
Oh, yeah?
Favorite side pocket break shots, but he was playing on 5x10 tables with clay balls.
Jeez.
That was a nice angle he got there. He needs to draw back about a foot. All right, Thorsten, let's see a run now. So far, so good. He wants a table wiped down. Yesterday we saw John Schmidt rake the balls in frustration.
Amazing.
Because his opponent got Kamui chalk all over the balls. You just can't keep some people happy. Kamui chalk costs $30 a cube in its home country. I think that's insanity. But I'm not the purchaser.
This stuff's pretty awesome, though. I tried it out, man. It's
$30 for a cube of chalk?
You only need it once. You only need to chalk once every couple games, from what I understand. But, yeah, it's pretty expensive stuff.
Having lived through an era in which the finest Rambo cube with 2 shafts cost $30, I'm a little skeptical about 1 cube of chalk for the same price.
Well, the one good thing about them, if you don't agree with the price of their chalk, is that they are doing a lot for pool. They've been sponsoring a lot of these events.
I'm all for that.
Yeah, they sponsored our stream.
I'm not saying their chalk isn't fine product. I'm just saying $30 seems
pricey.
Like an incredible price.
Gotcha. Yeah, I thought it felt like lipstick. It felt like putting on makeup.
That's what Minnesota Fats compared the act to. It's like a broad putting on lipstick when you chalk your cue.
That was a good one. Oh, man.
I believe Thorsten may be getting gray. He's barely 30 years old.
Yeah. Well, after running 178 and missing.
174.
74.
It was, and he didn't miss. It was 174.
He ran out.
Yeah.
Oh, nice. Boy, this is a tough little shot here. Look at
that.
Oh, gosh.
One more biscuit for breakfast.
Well, here comes the killer pixie. Look out.
Yeah. That could have helped.
Here he comes. He's going to run another 88, 86.
Actually, we saw him aiming that shot from the object ball side, and it looked to me like he was going to overcut the ball slightly.
Yeah,
he nearly got kissed out by another object ball.
Now, if another ball knocks the two ball in,
it's still good,
right?
Yeah. Ball and pocket are all you need to accomplish. The game doesn't care how.
Okay. Yeah, Thorsten, that's not good. But he just got a little funny on that break shot, so.
He went a little wider than he intended to. It doesn't mean it was unmakeable, though.
Mm-hmm.
Alex may be on a break here.
Yeah, he's taking a little restroom break.
A few degrees warmer in the tournament room than it is here, yeah. But I can understand why you might have to take several of those.
Mm-hmm. 2 5-minute breaks.
Okay. He's going to be very happy when he comes back and finds it's an open table for him.
Definitely.
I think I've heard that someplace.
Yeah.
Pat Fleming's from around there, too. You told me you lived near Patterson at one time. Okay, Alex is back at the table with open shots to greet him. In fact, I don't see any problems here. 10 balls the best break shot at the moment, and probably try and leave that alone.
I think I'm going to lose it again. Sorry.
lot of bridge work here, but Alex is correctly eliminating the balls below the break area. You want one ball down there until all the rest are open, and then you take it off. The reason for that is if your secondary break shot should send your cue ball down to the rail, you'll be grateful to have the company. But now is a good time to take it off. The rest of these balls can be sunk without touching a second ball, and that's the way they should be played. Came out harmlessly enough, but he did not need to run into that seven ball. 14 up table is a good proposition for him here. Players of Alex's stature, one of the factors in shot selection is what you can comfortably reach. Of course, you can always reach use the bridge or shoot left-handed, but you want to be comfortable at the table. The right shot in this game is generally the easiest shot that's still productive to your longer range thinking. And that would appear to be the 14 right now. Alvin sprinting back to his post.
There, he's got those.
Got that ball up on the rail again, that nine ball.
And he would correctly take it off right now.
Mm. A funny little smile on his face there. He always keeps in a good mood. That's what's important.
Oh yeah, he stays sunny, and he seems to be delighted by his own bewilderment at playing this game. The Filipinos have a tough time adjusting to the notion that there's a pool game where you can shoot any ball in any pocket at any time.
And the small amount of movement that's required in this game.
Yeah, that's right. And you know, position patterns, and there are many aspects of this game that are totally foreign to him, and it's fun to watch them try and figure it out as they go. Bustamante finished second here 1 year, and it was clear to everybody watching he was playing one ball at a time.
Yeah, well, I think the thing is I've been over to Manila, and their pool tables over there are like carpet. It felt like carpet. You really got to come with the shot when you...
I would have thought the opposite. The playing cloth would have been worn threadbare.
Yeah, it just seemed to... The ones that I play, and they have brass ferrules on the cues, which is another thing I noticed.
And it's real humid there, too. Of course.
That might be what it was.
It's humid in Florida, and good players come from Florida. Mm-hmm.
They have no air conditioning in Manila, though. That's maybe the difference.
Seminole Tour is one of the two best tours going right now, in my opinion, anyway.
Oh, yeah. Seminole Tour is amazing.
Seminole Tour and Mike Zuglin's tour in the Northeast, I think are the two best. I'm not that familiar with the rest, but I know those are two damn good ones.
Yeah, Great Southern Billiard Tour is great, too. Shannon Dalton's tour.
That's new, isn't it?
Yeah, it's pretty new. Him and Shannon and Marge run it. It's a great little tournament.
What I like about Mike Zuglin's tour is that he will not write a check even to players whose sponsors would prefer that he did. He pays off in cash, in full, and promptly.
Nice. Pool 9-2.
I'm not saying the others don't. I'm just saying I know that he does.
Sure. Pool 92465 says, from what I see, Filipinos can adjust pretty quickly to anything pool-related.
I would have to agree with him.
Mm-hmm.
But the straight pool position is very complex. The game is new to them, and they generally figure it out as they go.
Yeah.
You will not see them playing this game back home because although you can bet at it, it's much too slow. You can't pay off by the rack as you can with 8 and 9 ball.
They like that 15 ball rotation.
Call shot rotation is usually the game of choice.
Yeah, what an amazing game.
I don't think Efren ever played 9 ball till he came over here.
Man, that's crazy.
I know he didn't play any one pocket till he came here.
Man, 15-ball rotation, wow.
And Efren considers it a good practice when he's run 10 racks in a row of that.
Jeez.
If I ever ran one, I'd want a Nobel Prize.
Right. Wow, he's gotten funny on this.
No, he's all right. He can go two rails underneath the 10 ball here, assuming he can see the ball in the middle of the rack. This is Danny DiLiberto's favorite thing to do.
Yeah. Don't they just play for the spot ball? I guess not.
Assuming he can see the point of aim on the four, two rails around the object ball is what Danny likes to do, because he says once you cross that line, the angle is always working for you. Mm. If you happen to get straight in on the ball in the rack, shoot it in and take ball in hand. This should be played with left-hand English and two rails around the 10, just like that. Very good.
Well, he looks a little... He's going to be able to catch that bottom corner ball off this break, I guess.
I think he will probably try and draw into the top.
Draw into the top?
Yeah, it's much safer than following and trying to catch the corner ball.
The risk
in catching the corner ball is if you catch it too high, you have a diagonal path straight to the subway. There are times when you don't have any choice but to risk it, but he doesn't have to do that here. Two best Filipino straight pool players would be Efren and Jose Perica, who was here. Had a very bad game against Mike Siegel, but he plays a very, very polished game of straight pool. Mm.
Alex has won the World Nine Ball Championship, as well as many other titles.
The Snooker Championship of Canada.
Sure, that World Nine Ball is probably his biggest win. But Efren won the World Nine Ball Championship too, I believe. I'm not sure though. You would probably know that more than I, George.
I really don't follow Asian pool as closely as I do pool here. But gotcha. Efren's won almost everything inside, mm-hmm. except he has not won in straight pool.
Yeah, and...
Finished second to Ralph's okay one year. Okay. That was in New York in 2000. I think 2000.
I know that our chatters out there will know the answer to that. If Efren had won the... Efren won in 99, says Steve.
I'm certainly willing to take his word for things. I know it was 2000 when he finished second to Ralph's okay. That tournament was held at Roseland in Manhattan, the concert venue and ballroom.
It's really nice having the amount of knowledge in the chat, as well as your knowledge,
absolutely.
George, it really is
absolutely
very unique to have two great sources of information for questions that I have.
I appreciate our viewers clocking in.
Mm-hmm.
I'm happy to learn. If Alex soft rolls this three ball in, he can use the 8 to separate the 9 and 11. That's the last problem on the table. He chose to go another way. Had he come up a bit higher, he could have used the 12 to separate those two balls. And I think he's straight in on that. Oh, it's the 15. 12 is over here on the red, I guess. At any rate, he didn't get the position he wanted. It's the 12, and it goes past the 13. I didn't think it did. 13-4 looks like... 13-7 looks like it will be his cue ball, break ball combination, I think. Can't be sure of anything with Alex.
Definitely. Yeah, I thought that he was going to be using that ball as his break ball.
Well, he still may. I don't know that he's necessarily going to shoot it. I wouldn't.
No. He's not going to.
No. Well, yeah, I wonder what his plans to do with those three balls on the left-hand rail. I'll get my answer soon enough.
Yeah, it looks like he's going to pick off the 6 now and then go for the 11, roll up for the 9, then go for the 8.
He has a small window for position on the 11 up table. He can do that, and he wouldn't have to separate the balls. That's what he's got.
He just wanted to roll up on it. Nice. He didn't take that 11 ball. That is so strange.
I'm surprised myself. I think he's looking for a window to get to the 9 ball cleanly, and that's a pretty narrow window.
Jeez.
Oh, yeah, he had the 11 ball staring him right in the face.
Sure did. But he must have a plan that I don't see, which is not surprising considering he's a master pool player, and I am not.
He's not looking at this. Is he going to try and shoot the 9? I guess he is. He thinks he has room. It's awful hard for us to tell on screen.
Yeah, it is. We're working on that, though.
He'd probably follow this and shoot the 11 back the other way. No, he didn't. He's
going to shoot it in the same hole.
He drew, same hole.
Playing one pocket here. He could actually play all these balls into his...
It could be. Siegel likes to take off quadrants of the table like that.
He does.
Yeah.
It's good. It's like mind training.
Sure it
is. It's interesting. It's like a meditation almost, this game.
That's how I play it. I hit the balls for 2 hours a day, and it serves the same purpose as meditation does.
Yeah, your mind gets real quiet. You can't really think about other things.
You get lost.
So the referee calls each shot, like in the old days. Did they do that because there were so many people in the crowd that people couldn't see what the ball was?
Or couldn't tell what shot was being played. If he calls the wrong ball that the player did not intend to shoot, the player is obligated to correct him. I saw Moscone do that once. It wasn't very dignified. It was something like, what, are you crazy? I'm playing the 6 on the side. If you don't correct the referee and you pocket a ball other than the one he called, it doesn't count.
Really?
Yeah. But, you know, the referees are knowledgeable, and that kind of mistake doesn't come up very often.
I see. Well, he's on another little run here.
Yeah, he's lost another one. Well, that's what happens when you miss a break shot and splatter the balls. Okay. Two racks more, so Alex is in the 110s.
Okay.
Thorsten has a few. This surprises me. Doesn't flabbergast me, but it surprises me.
Now, they chose New Jersey for this. For any particular reason, or is this a straight pool town?
They have been here before, not at this hotel, the New Brunswick Hilton, but... New York and New Jersey have traditionally been mecca for straight pool for decades, certainly East.
I see.
And that was the game of choice. I mean, you heard Ray Martin's speech the other night at his induction. We would all get together in the same pool room, all the great players from Jersey, and some would come down from New York. We'd match up and play semi-cheap. But you could go to that pool room, and you were guaranteed that you would get to see somebody running some balls.
Nice.
Gene Belukas used to come down from New York to play with the Jersey players.
Now, this isn't as extreme of an angle as Thorsten missed.
No,
this
it's not. It's basically the same shot. It's not quite as acute an angle.
It's pretty easy for Alex here.
You won't be able to tell from this angle if he's misaiming this, and he's probably not.
Yeah. But the speed, you got to hit that ball into the rack. It's easy to jar it.
That last break shot is a direct product of new cloth and polished balls. The balls would not normally fly apart that way, it being struck that softly, which is fine. You should take advantage of the equipment and the conditions.
Yeah, you probably want to play it softer than normal.
Softer is better. Almost everything, and almost everything in life, softer is better, with one exception, and our viewers don't need to be reminded.
We definitely want to thank Olhausen for bringing in their tables and their fine mechanics that they had here, Mike and Rex. And
Their staff is as good as anybody's in the world.
If Olhausen's listening out there, you guys got some good workers there. So
you earned a lot of goodwill here.
You guys picked the right guys. I'm enjoying this Olhausen tables, watching the play. It's so consistent.
The players seem to be very happy with things. The pockets are not as drastic as the diamonds.
Right.
But they're playing fair.
Playing very consistent, all the rails.
If you get the pocket, you get the shot, for the most part. And they reject balls which are not struck cleanly enough. That's what they should be doing.
Yep. Amplify the error, for sure.
I think that he will play the 15 here and bump the strike ball on the rail.
Want some water? You want a little water?
Yeah, I'd like that. Yeah, that's fine. Thank you. Well, once again, Alex found something other than what I saw. That's fine, too. Don't touch anything. No, that's all right. Alex would be smart to leave the 10 where it is, because it's very valuable in getting on the 3 across the table he's not going to do that either. 3 ball is going to for sure be his key ball, I would think. 5 ball up table needs to be dealt with. Thank you.
The Lion. Is he stuck or what's?
No, he's not stuck. He's trying to figure out a route to the 5 ball up table here. Suggest the best way to get there would be off the 8 ball. And wrong again.
He almost jarred that ball. I
think actually he chose the right shot there. If he goes from the 5 to the 8, the 8 is in good position to get to the 3. Not as good as the 10, but still good. Alex is going to roll his sleeve. Or button it, one of the two. Actually, he didn't do either one. I'll leave it flapping in the breeze.
Pool 92 says, if Alex wins this tournament, can they call him the best straight pool player in the world? He just learned the game a week ago.
Well, he's had a little more experience than that. Actually, I'm not sure he played straight pool at all before the last Derby City, and that's not straight pool until the high run contestants are determined. But he's playing better patterns now than he was 7 months ago, and I credit that to his natural pool instincts rather than any instruction. I can't imagine he studied this game much.
Right.
He did leave this ball go too far in his sequence, but it's recoupable. He's got an angle on it. Might even use the 6 to get on the 9. Depending on the angle, it'd probably be the 9 to get on the 6. This would not qualify as 2 break shots because the 9 ball would be a break shot only as a last ditch. And 114 to 11 for Alex Pagulayan.
It's going to be more than that now.
No, rescored.
Plus
okay.
14.
Plus 14. So 128 to 11. Are there fouls? Have there been fouls?
I am not sure.
I don't remember seeing any.
Yeah.
So the score should add up to a multiple of 14.
Yep, 128 to 11.
That's 2 balls short of where it should be, or 1 ball short of where it should be.
Oh, see, even the refs don't know. Nobody seems to be able to score this right.
If there have been no fouls, the score should reflect a multiple of 14.
Well, we've seen this. This is the third match now that there's been question on what the real score is.
I'm sure there have been more.
No, they're saying up there, the scorekeepers are saying a 128
to 11, so there's been a foul somewhere in there. I'm trying to remember where it was.
Mm-hmm.
Charlie took a time foul last game. Seemed like he was on the clock almost every shot once they put the clock on him.
There's Jerry T in the background doing some video work.
He's done some wonderful stuff work for this tournament.
Yeah, he's a cool guy. I like Jerry.
Nice video presentation he put together for Ray.
Most would say that we're competition, but I really like Jerry. So
yeah, it's a small world. Give the competition their props.
Yeah.
NYC Grind does a great job.
Sure. I like Jerry a lot. He's cool.
I've never met him, but I appreciate the work he's done.
Yeah, he's a good kid.
And plays a nice game, too.
Mm. Yeah, he played in this event. All right, the Lion. He's going to go for that break ball on the other side of the rack this time.
Makes no difference, except in terms of reachability, it's a little tougher stretch for him, but in terms of pocketing the ball, same thing.
Okay. Looks like he's going to draw into the 1.
Doesn't have to draw. Goes right into the 1 naturally.
90 degrees. He actually threw some forward on that.
Perfect.
Beauty. Did Alex start at -1?
Not that I'm aware of.
Where was the foul?
No.
The score doesn't reflect the...
Thorsten broke and Alex missed. There was no foul in that rack.
We're having a problem with the score here.
And the score is 1 point off what it should be if there have been no fouls.
Carl's...
There was a scratch?
Alright. Okay. Thank you. Carl's going to check out the...
The classic straight pool pattern here would begin with the 1 up table and take those 2 balls near the side pocket off. No rule says you have to play according to what the purists would do.
Scratch in the corner, says Duker 509. There was a foul maybe second rack then.
Ah, okay.
I don't remember.
Scratch in the corner. I don't remember it either. Mm-mm. But if he says that sounds valid to me.
Our chatters, they're right on.
They're watching this. We're trying to call this on a ball by ball basis.
Oh, now see, Steve says no scratch.
Then the score's off a ball.
Well, we're going to find out. Carl's over there checking it out for us.
Okay. Alex will use this as a break shot at the clusters. Only five balls. You don't have to hit him with a nine-ball break. All you have to do is separate him slightly like that.
Nice.
Well, he's got two more to deal with. Oh, that's right. The safety battle developed, and Alex got the first open ball. Thank you.
Yeah. Intentional.
Mm-hmm. I remember now.
D. Ludd got it right.
Probably deal with the 14-5 right here.
Mm-hmm. Bink.
And then the 11-3 uh-huh. needs to be solved, and that's the last problem. The 8 ball is inconvenient on the side rail up table there.
Alex was just doing a little hoo-joo on that ball, trying to make it do what he wanted it to do.
Sometimes it seems that the balls will obey your commands, and most of the time not.
Right.
I don't know what he said, but it seemed to delight the crowd.
That's too funny.
The referee must have said something to him there.
Jose. He's crediting the referee for coaching.
Got the great Jose Burgos in the booth here just hanging out. It's a buck 28 to 11, Jose. Nice. Man, you've really been troopering it out today, George. This is about hour 6 for you, commentating.
Five. Entering hour 6.
Yeah. I know our viewers are enjoying listening to you.
I'm glad to hear that.
Makes it worth it a little bit, huh?
Sure it does. If Alex had dealt with that 8 ball earlier in this progression, he could have saved the 10, 8, and 5 for last.
I see.
I didn't care for that. I would have rather seen him shoot the 8. The 5 ball was already a break ball.
Right.
He didn't leave himself shotless, but he really doesn't have much of a break ball here. The 8 ball barely clears the rack.
Now, if you land the cue ball in the rack, you get ball in hand in the kitchen at the break, right?
Yes.
I wonder, I haven't seen a lot of that where they're playing balls into the rack or the cue ball into the rack.
No.
I haven't seen a lot of that this tournament. Maybe once or twice.
Players would rather not take ball in hand behind the string, but, if it keeps your run alive, it keeps your run alive.
Mm-hmm. Oh, they don't play that because that's a long shot across the table, maybe.
Well, some players are more adept than others at shooting. One player's name comes up consistently as the best shot maker among his peers is Mike Deshane from Maine.
Mm-hmm.
And he's getting those plaudits from people who play games where shot making is 90% of the game. So that's really a high level of praise.
Jerry says, Alex actually plays standard old school patterns but will shoot up table more than the old guys.
Well, he has a point there. The only one of the old-timers who would consistently shoot up table was Moscone, and we all know what happened when Moscone played his peers.
Hmm.
The peers came in second.
Wow.
It is true that when good players play, close to 90% of the scoring will be in the bottom two pockets.
Mm-hmm.
And that was certainly true in Moscone's era, but all six pockets still count.
So he played that good, huh? You saw him playing.
I've seen him play a number of times, and I've seen him lose. And he was not happy about it. Hmm. He was gracious, but he wasn't happy.
Yeah.
little question Alex could be a great straight pool player should he choose to be, but he doesn't see any future in it. Alex is interested in gambling.
Yep. He looks at the object ball last.
Most players do, except on shots where the cue ball is extremely close to the object ball. Reverse English that time.
Nice.
And it worked out just right.
That was a nice shot.
Yes, it was. Inside English to the rescue again.
Takes a lot of skill to hit that inside English right.
Sure does. Most players aren't comfortable with it.
I was told by a pretty good shooter that outside English puts the ball in the hole. You know, they said if you're ever in question, use outside English. Pocket the ball.
The instruction I received is do not spin an object ball into a hole unless absolutely mandatory. Either English will deflect the object ball in the opposite direction. I mean, there's still, it's basic physics, and these are still revolving spheres. But inside English lets you do so many things for position that outside English will not allow you to do. If you have a, say you have a shot that's a few degrees removed from being straight in, inside English will help you draw the ball back much closer to your point of origin than outside English will.
Oh. Yeah, outside will throw you off course.
Yeah, outside's going to take you to veer off.
Interesting.
Inside draw will help you preserve that.
Pro pool player Marty Herman says, Brunswick and Willie had a deal. You buy our tables, Willie comes to your opening of your room and runs 150.
Yes, if you opened a room with Brunswick tables, the Brunswick advisory staff was available for exhibitions. He wasn't the only player they signed. He was the one that was most in demand.
Good advertising.
Yeah, extremely good.
Marketing.
Yeah, absolutely. I saw him play in several new rooms. Overcut. And badly. Now let's see what Thorsten can do. Alex wasn't really close to that. Thorsten appears to have a dead shot to the pocket where the eight ball is now. But I think he will probably use the eight to fall on the 14 here. We had a room in Chicago's Chinatown area where Moscone was invited to play an exhibition, and he did so for an appearance fee plus half the gate. And he ran 150 out on everybody he played, just about.
Wow.
Next up was Minnesota Fats, and the proprietor was asked, what kind of deal did you make with him? He said, oh, I got a great deal with Fats. What'd you have to give him? I only had to give him all the money. All the money, everybody, all the gate, everything. I had to give him all that. And he had 5-6 attempts at each trick shot that was downright embarrassing. But those were the conditions that prevailed.
He probably chucked it up and laughed it up, and the crowd probably had a great time, and they probably had a better time if he would have.
I wasn't there. My friend Freddie the Beard was.
Nice.
I'm sure the crowd enjoyed it, regardless of his success, but right. 4 or 5 attempts at the same trick shot gets to be embarrassing.
Yeah. Pro pool player says he'd run 150 like nothing. It was unreal how easy he was doing it.
Exactly right. And one of his secrets was that because he provided his own set of well-waxed balls and demanded new cloth every time he played, wow, he never drove anything very far from the racking area, so that his runs actually began to resemble one another.
Wow. Yeah, I see that in 9-ball sometimes a lot.
Yeah.
In 10-ball.
Patterns do recur.
Mm-hmm. Of course, patterns with 15 balls is unusual. I mean, that's going to be a lot more of a chaotic thing
to control.
But wow.
Moscone is the only player we've ever had who claimed to be able to think 6 balls ahead.
Wow.
The norm for most experts is 3.
Mm-hmm.
But he played such effortless position, like our viewer says, that you could predict his next 6 shots and you'd be right at least 80% of the time.
Wow. Now, Jerry says, does anyone know how Freddie the Beard is?
He's fine. Overweight, but fine.
Well, there you go. There's your answer.
Freddie is 28 months younger than I. And a marketing colossus. He'll sell you just about anything there is. He's got other players' books and DVDs and his own shirts, of course, and discount cues and most anything. And he blogs.
Nice. You know what his site is?
Bankingwiththebeard.com.
There you go, Freddie. Don't say we inside pool never helped you out.
Oh, was the caller's name Freddie, too?
Speaking of colleges, we're here at Rutgers University area.
Not far, New Brunswick,
New Jersey. Quite a hustling, bustling town, I'd say.
Is Rutgers considered to be an Ivy League school?
I'm not sure. They had the football team here at the hotel, and they had armed guards, and it was
the
president was here. It was incredible. Yeah. I mean, they consider these football players like gods.
I went to school in Madison, Wisconsin, and there was a...
Oh, I love Madison,
There was a prime rib buffet on Sunday nights. You could catch the whole football team there. God knows how much they ate.
Hmm. Yeah, I'd go to the Wisconsin Dells quite a bit over there.
That's about an hour from Madison.
Yeah. Nice area.
Thorsten underachieved on this particular shot. He can cut that 8-ball on the side, but he's not very comfortable with that, and nor should he be.
Jeez.
I don't know how he got into this. I guess he underhit the cue ball. He underdrew.
We haven't seen him in an hour.
What's it going to be here? Oh, the 8 in the corner in 3 rail position. Very nice. Very nice. This has been a tough rack for Thorsten. Still 3 clusters remain, which he has to deal with.
Seminal Tour says, no, it's not an Ivy League school.
Fair enough.
Rutgers.
Yeah.
Rutgers. Okay. I was just asking. State school.
State.
Okay.
1776.
Wow. I was surprised to learn that the oldest college in this nation, or at least the college it claims to be, is the University of Louisville.
Louisville.
Or as the natives say, Louisville.
Louisville. Louisville.
Two syllables.
Louisville.
Mm-hmm. Wrote a column once called Clueless in Louisville.
Nice.
It was about Freddie.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's the State University of New Jersey, right?
All-male school in 1961.
Oh.
Undefeated football team. Alex Coles.
I would think out east here, basketball would be king.
Rutgers was wrestling and football. Football.
Gladiator sports.
He has a chance to break 2 clusters with this, if he can get in between the 1 and the ball above the 9, just like this. Oh, he didn't get the 2nd cluster.
Uh-oh.
He can get it now, though. Then he has to deal with the 5-10. maybe considering the 10 ball up table here. I'm not sure what this is about. I think he's looking to see if both these balls over to our left go in the right-hand corner, but I'm not really certain. The fact that he's had three clusters to deal with is, now he has one.
Why are they calling Thorsten Toasty?
I think it's a nickname off his off his first name. The English version of Thorsten his first name would be Toasty. Would be Thurston.
Toasty. I like
or,
that.
Or Thornton.
Looks like somebody said something funny. They said, Toasty looks like he's going to star in a musical after this event.
Glee, maybe.
Glee. Musical, huh? Nice.
That's interesting. I wouldn't have thought of that role for him.
Yeah, that's a good one.
So he barely looks to be 20 years old. He's actually in his early 30s. Mm-hmm. That was some shot there. This will enable him to save the ball above the five as a key ball, I think. Unless he plays the ball nearest us first, he's going to shoot the 12 and bump that ball towards the rail. I think I would have preferred to play this ball in the same pocket he just scored in, but he's going to come around and play that 10 on the other side, it looks like.
Okay, Thorsten was born July 14th, 1979, so he's 32.
Okay, his birthday's 4 days before mine.
Career winning $658,000.
And 12 days before Mick Jagger's.
As of early 2007, estimated at almost 700,000 total winnings.
All right, so he's Cancerian. That means he's gentle and doesn't travel well. I am eager for Thorsten to run some balls. So is he, but I'm speaking on behalf of our viewers as well as myself. I want to show our viewers a match in which both players come to play. Nice. It's as big a contrast in playing styles as we've had.
Thorsten's going to take a little break. Referee's going to take a little break.
You know what? I'm going to stretch my legs.
Go for it.
All right.
Good job. Stop back when you can. Hohmann signed to be managed by Dragon Promotions, who transplanted the German resident to Jacksonville, Florida as a base of practice and preparation for U.S. competition. Hohmann then signed with his current Q sponsor. 2004, Hohmann reached the finals of the U.S. Open Nine Ball Championships. He lost to Gabo in 3-11. 2005 was his most successful date to date. BCA Open 9-Ball Championship, Sudden Death 7-Ball, Whirlpool League. 2006, he won the World Straight Pull Championship. Thomas Engert, 200-80. Won the IPT North American 8-Ball Championship, $350,000 he won for that one. Nice. Largest prize pool ever, tournament ever. Efren beat that shortly, 500,000 in 2006. 200 players did not collect their money. Hohmann is still on the record as the biggest purse winner in billiards history to actually get paid. He's the 2003 World Nine Ball Champion, 2003 New Jersey 14-1 Championship, 2003 German Nine Ball Champion, 2005 BCA Open Nine Ball, 2005 Sudden Death, and on and on and on and on. Thorsten spends most of his time traveling the world, but lives in Jacksonville, Florida. Well, there you go, my friend. Little background information.
What's that?
Also, apparently, has won the Philippine Championship. I know that our chatties out there know more than you, Wikipedia does, that's for sure. Well, that was fast.
Wanted to, but we're celebrating celebrating the return of Thorsten, Alex, and George here.
Yeah, if you need to take a break, you just go right ahead, man. You're a trooper. Been here all day.
I'll be more productive on the next break. I have to remember which direction the elevators are and which direction the restrooms are, and I'll be fine.
He won two straight U.S. Opens in this game, says pro pool player.
Yes, he's won this tournament twice. They play such good straight pool in Germany that it's really hard to know who the best player is. The best record belongs to Oliver Ortmann, who has won 80-some German championships in all the disciplines except for one pocket. They play straight pool over there regularly.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Well, not to interrupt you, we were just talking about IPT not paying, but World Pro says Efren got paid all his money, and so did everyone else. So.
Oh, there's no question about that. He did pay off.
Okay, well, they
he wound up disappointing quite a few people, however. Wow. He paid everybody, and he didn't have to. He could have hid behind the lawyers, but he paid off.
Good job.
I don't dispute that
at
all.
They hadn't updated the Wikipedia article that I looked at.
Okay. It didn't pan out into the $2 million venture that he promised, but he did pay his debts, so let's give him credit for that. My friend Larry Schwartz was at the bottom rung of that tour, and he looked forward to his check every month.
Well, in all fairness, I saw how the players were acting to Kevin Trudeau, and they were all trying to get money off of him, borrow money, get paid in advance. Mm-hmm. Every scam you could think of, they were trying to play on him.
Know, they recognize a man with money. And
it was take advantage of him time. Not to give him any, you know, but the way that I saw they were acting to him, I don't blame him at all for pulling out.
He could have stiffed the field for that last million plus, but he paid, and the last I heard he was planning something different, but I didn't want to comment on Kevin Trudeau until somebody helped me understand what his grand scheme was to begin with. There was no Hong Kong billionaire to whom he planned to sell the tour,
right?
Or if there was, American players could prepare for a career in Asia. So I don't think that was valid at all, if he got control of all the pool in North America tomorrow morning, he still wouldn't have a way to make a buck with it. Yeah. So I really don't know what his scheme was. I don't know what he saw in pool. I don't think it was strictly that he wanted to do something for pool players. I mean, there had to be something in it for him. That's only fair.
Well, that online gambling was going off, and then as soon as the government saw that he was going to do that, they put a law in right away.
Well, they've been watching him pretty close.
Yeah.
And I told Larry Schwartz, if you cash any one of those checks, it's a legal binding contract that you accept his terms. And he said, that's fine. I expect him to pay off in full. And he did.
Mm-hmm.
This is the 50-yard line.
Sure is.
Halfway in between a good shot in the corner for that 13 or a good shot in the side. But it should come off and soon.
Yeah, he needs to get rid of that ball. Looks like they're talking about Pepsi's going to sponsor the U.S. Open 9-ball.
Really?
Yeah.
Barry Behrman's tournament? He got Pepsi as a sponsor?
I believe that's what I'm reading on the chat here.
Gosh, there's been so much to do about that tournament. We're going to boycott. We're not going to boycott. I didn't really understand the reasons for the boycott in the first place, except that the players wanted to be assured that they would be paid, and I support that. But if that threat included seeded tournaments, I couldn't be more opposed.
Pepsi's going to give $25,000 to the tournament, and Seminole Tour saying that's true, Upstate Al saying it's true, Pro Pool players, everybody's saying that's true.
Yeah, it's the first I've heard of it, but I certainly can't refute it.
AZ Jerry says they're going to give three cases of pop for a sponsorship.
Three cases of pop.
Three cases of soda.
That sounds more realistic than $20,000. Reynolds didn't want us. Well, they tried it for a year and decided this is not the way to reach the masses. Mm-hmm. I don't think Earl Strickland's quitting in the finals of the last tournament they staged did the tour any good. But
oh, he did?
Yes.
I didn't know about that.
He objected to Corey Duell's soft break and he quit. And it was the last straw. I'm not saying that Reynolds immediately resigned because of what he did, but it didn't help.
That
was the first way anybody ever saw Corey Duell's soft break.
You know, and that's funny that Corey has so much respect for Earl. Like, that's one of his favorite players, you know.
So. Yeah, it's hard not to respect Earl's pool. Mm-hmm. Actually, Earl plays a fine game of straight pool. I haven't seen him compete at it, but I've seen him practice it, and he takes the balls off the table very sophisticatedly, and he claims a long run of over 400.
Yeah, Earl told me straight pool is his favorite game, is his best game, is what he said.
I'm not surprised to hear it. It's just the pool never really gave him a venue in which to perform it.
Well, he's banned from these tournaments. He's not allowed to play in any tournament.
He doesn't get along with Charlie?
I believe Cindy Lee banned him for talking or being obnoxious or something.
I don't
know the exact reason.
It's not that hard to believe.
Yeah. Yeah, she said he doesn't even bother asking to play in any of her events.
Certainly give the man credit for experimentation. He's tried just about every kind of gear and accessory known to mankind.
Yeah, that new Q seems to be working pretty good for him.
New Q looks like it was borrowed from Yao Ming.
It's the javelin.
Weights on each hand, weights on his feet, blue blocking glasses.
Oh, yeah. He was dragging around two weights on his foot at the Seminole Tour. He's dragging him around the table.
Two weights on his feet.
On one foot.
And bells on his toes.
He put it on his hand, too. He wrapped the weight around
his... Yeah, wrist weights, ankle weights.
But he was using his big weight on his bridge on his hand.
I've experimented with headsets, and that's about as far as I've gone in that direction. But, you know, whatever helps you put the balls in the hole. He's in his 50s now, and his game has really not slipped. But I don't think he'll get back into the Moscone Cup. I heard there were 11 or 12 players who said they wouldn't play if he was on the team. And the Europeans don't even want him around. They used to want him around because if he melted down, it was good for TV ratings, but the players got tired of it.
Yeah, he got too much. He's starting to get too much.
Yeah, there's
a... That's why he's got his new House of Earl, the studio they're building down in Florida for him to do all his matches so he can do whatever he wants.
Oh, really? Who's building this?
Ice House Billiards is Mike Moosey and Gary Patrick and us inside pool. We're going to be doing all the video down there. It's going to be like our video studio. It's going to be a 70-seat arena with a 10-foot table and a 9-foot table down in the bottom. And we'll be doing challenge matches with Earl and other players.
So it's like what AccuStats has.
Yeah, it's called the House of Earl.
Okay, House of Earl.
Yeah, the House of Earl.
All right. Actually, away from the table, most people think he's a sweetheart.
He's a great guy. I like Earl a lot.
Freddie put him up for a while when he was in Chicago before anybody ever heard of him. He slept at Freddie's club.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Two clusters remain for Thorsten to deal with. On the bottom rail and over here to our right. And he just broke up the two to our right, so that was a very efficient little shot there. I think he'll play position for the one ball here off the eight. Charlie shot a shot like this last night, and on the small screen, it barely looks makeable. That was lovely.
Yeah, really nice.
The nine ball gives him an opportunity to come down here and play the 12 once the eight is gone, but the eight illustrates the importance of clearing paths to the corner pockets. Mm. That's if he doesn't want the 2-12 combination, and it doesn't offer any real advantage to him. He's looking at it.
Yeah, all it does is possibly make him miss.
Well, he'll make it if he shoots it, but it takes the first ball out of consideration as a break shot. Yeah. It's going to slide over towards the rail if he plays that shot.
Right, so he needs to get on that ball using the nine ball?
Yeah, I think he should probably – I think he wants to take the eight ball off the table, and then he can use the nine to get on the 12.
I see. It clears the path.
And there's a ball up table for him to deal with, too.
Mm-hmm.
If he likes, he can shoot the 1 and then use the 8 to go into the 2 and 12, move one or the other.
Jerry says the highest runs in the last 10 years are Engert, 492, Cohen, 431, and Hohmann, believe he said 418 is what Thorsten said he ran.
I was told that the first player named ran 499. Mm. I called one of his games once. He was playing Jimmy Rempe.
Mm-hmm.
And he won, and after the game, Rempe said, but he sharked me. Some people can't be made happy. I don't dispute what he says.
Hmm.
In fact, he went to the finals 1 year against Thorsten, and Thorsten just took care of the 12. Thorsten had to ask the referee to get Engert to stop fidgeting in the chair.
Wow.
And he complied. He complied. Lost a match to Bobby Hunter 1 year when he went behind his back, needing fewer than 10 balls. He went behind his back for an easy rail shot. I don't know why he didn't take the bridge, but he jawed the ball and lost the match.
Wow.
Thorsten has left that ball up table longer than he usually does, and he's left his 8 ball longer than he usually does.
They're talking about Babe Cranfield's 600 and 700 ball runs.
768 is what he claimed.
Hmm.
His co-author, a Syracuse attorney, merely said if Babe says he ran 768, then he ran 768.
Wow.
One of our friends online said he racked the balls for the man for consecutive practice runs exceeding 450. Consecutive practice runs exceeding 450.
Wow.
Many people saw him run 30 racks on a 5x10 in a Syracuse exhibition. And he's still the only player to have won national, amateur, junior, and world titles.
Wow. Nice.
I never saw him play in his prime. He's a terrific athlete. He played good table tennis, good bowler, good tennis player. Did everything well. And he was an executive with the Muzak Music Systems. The music you hate to hear in the elevator. Thorsten will go to the top rail and back here. That's what you want. This is about as good an angle as you could want on that ball, allowing that it shouldn't still be there. Thorsten will recheck to make sure he doesn't leave himself an angle in which he overcuts the break as he did earlier. And lost many racks in the doing.
Mm. Yeah, sure did.
That's good. All right.
Series
we're seeing, this is a three rack run, and we're seeing signs that Thorsten's coming to life. Mm-hmm. I certainly hope so for our viewers and for us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's got a good angle into the pack here to clip off that corner ball maybe, or the
yes,
top barrels.
Well, no, at this angle, it's much safer to go into the corner ball.
Okay.
And as soon as they're wrecked, I'll see where I think he's going to go. Mm-hmm. Let me turn the camera around. I'll be able to see where that ball is in relation to the stack a little better.
Definitely want to thank Cindy Lee and Dragon Promotions and Charlie Williams.
Yes, and here she is Sweet, with more wonderful peaches.
Love peaches.
Life-saving peaches. Mm. Nice. He's going to draw, and he's going to draw with some force because he figures to take on the interior balls here. And this is, and there he goes up to the head rail and back again. I pointed this out last night. Many European players do this, but Thorsten is foremost among them. And you wouldn't want to try that if new cloth were not on the table. Sure, he's disappointed to find himself on the side rail, but hitting the ball that hard, you really can't be sure of its destination. Nice combination shot there.
Chogan says, if Thorsten runs out, wouldn't he break his old record?
Yes.
Yep. 189.
I don't know that we're going to see that, but you can't rule it out completely with a player like this.
He's still
at the table. He's awesome when he gets going. He really is.
Mm-hmm.
I think you'll see him play position for that stripe ball. Just past the six there and save the six for an insurance ball.
It's amazing. Alex got up to 142 in like half an hour.
No time at all.
No time at all. It took Johnny and Charlie to get almost 3.5 hours to get to 150.
Yes, it did. Yes, it did. No one knows better than JR and I.
Yeah, you guys were crushing. I bet you had a good story time there.
We needed one.
Uh-huh. Sure you had lots of stories to tell. DiLiberto said Hohmann was the best 14-1 player he's ever saw play, says world pro Bobby Chamberlain.
I heard the same quote. He told me that directly.
Hmm.
And he's seen Moscone, although he hates Moscone.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I didn't expect Thorsten to go into the cluster with that ball.
That eight rolled off there a little bit, I noticed.
A little bit, but the seven ball's still available to the side pocket, so it's not really a problem. Both balls could go in the upper left-hand corner if he needed them to. Oh. Cindy Lee strikes out for once. Just a terrible peach.
More like an apple, huh?
Yes. I'm eyeing your peach over there on the speaker, or in that case.
Oh, yeah, that's a good. Those are good ones.
Those are good ones.
But
yeah, he's going to go up table right now.
I like them Georgia peaches.
Everybody does. Uh-huh. Every third street in Atlanta is called Peachtree.
Nice. Mr. Sparkly. Toasty.
I wouldn't call him either of those things, but I guess I'm not uncomfortable hearing it. Toasty.
Toasty. I'm sure Thorsten would laugh about that. He's a pretty easygoing guy.
No, I think he's very low-key. Mm-hmm. I haven't had any words with him, but he certainly gives that impression.
Mm-hmm.
away from the table and he puts his glasses on. He looks like he's waiting to deliver his doctorate dissertation. Very studious, you know.
Yeah. Always well dressed, always well presented.
Yeah.
Very
you,
German.
You can say the same thing of all the European players, really.
Yeah. And the Germans pride themselves in the details, so. Nice shot.
A nice hand for 50. Actually, what the peach needs is a couple days in a brown paper bag. But it isn't terribly desirable right now.
Soften it up a little bit, huh?
Yeah, you're going to need a good set of teeth to take this sucker around.
We'll have to put it in the Vitamix for you. Blend it up.
Yeah, that's asking a lot of your blender.
Okay, they're asking you a question, George. Mr. Hoppy says, does George remember Wendell Weir from Chicago, 200 ball runner?
Extremely well.
Nice.
Extremely well. Wendell plays good billiards and good chess, too. There's the break shot. I was wondering where it was going to come from. That seven ball is still in a troublesome location. I haven't seen Wendell in a while, but the last time I did, he was in a one-pocket competition, and he lost to Indiana's Mark Jarvis. I don't think his game is where it was in the 70s. But since he's asked about Wendell Weir, though, my Wendell Weir story is that when I wrote my first book, I asked him for some feedback. And I showed him the book, and he read a few pages, and I could see him laughing, and he said, yeah, I like this. It makes you feel like playing. Come on, I'll give you $75 to $150 for $3. And he beat me 150 to 7 in two innings, which I consider to be a very high form of praise for my book. But I haven't seen Wendell in a while. Some people call him Shane. I think his given name is Shane Wendell Weir. I'm not aware that he ran 200, but I wouldn't be surprised to hear it. Played a good game of straight pool. And one of the first players he beat when he showed up in Chicago was the legendary New York shortstop everybody called Pancho. So, yeah, once he beat Pancho, he didn't get any more action. Pancho was a character originally from Forest Hills who pretended to be Italian his entire adult life. He was either Vince Furio or Vince Corelli all his adult life. He was born Harvey Strauss. And he could play. He hung around with good players. Red, Jersey Red, Brooklyn Jimmy, Hervolino. He's from that era. He's gone now. And complications of diabetes. And he spent his last few months living in Freddie's house.
Shane was Wendell's road name.
Road name.
Says Mr. Hoppy.
Okay. He knows him better than I do, but I know him fairly well. Haven't seen him in a couple of years. Mm-hmm. Think he's still around Chicago.
67 to 142 is our current score.
Okay. 75 balls is not too much for Thorsten to overcome. It largely boils down to what he gets out of his break shots like this one. There he goes all the way back again, and he just barely beat the side of the corner pocket
sure
scratch
did.
That time. I can't say I endorse that, although I appreciate that he's taking advantage of the new cloth. It adds so many variables to what you're doing. And, you know, sending the cue ball on that long a mission is to sacrifice control over it. Could probably have to roll this ball down the rail whether he likes it or not. Side pocket points don't seem terribly intrusive on these tables. There we go. Speed helps. That was fine. Mm-hmm. Kind of nice he fell on that ball to go up into that four-ball cluster.
He's going to break them here.
Yep. Separate is a better word.
Separate.
Don't have to drive him far.
I figured he would have got more out of it than that.
Yeah, that shot wasn't quite as productive as he had hoped. Mm-hmm. More mini problems to solve.
Nice.
That still only turned loose of one ball, and he has to make this combination here.
Wow.
And the one, I wonder if the one ball can go in this left-hand corner once the 10 is gone. That's been a stubborn little cluster in the center of the table. There, mm-hmm. He's tried to break it three different times. Ooh. That's nice position for 13 on the side if he wants it here.